All right, here we are in part two. We're going to be looking at theories of deviance. Just to reiterate, many of these theories are coming under particular perspectives. So the first perspective that we're going to be looking at is a biological perspective. The biological perspective sees crime and deviance as inherent in one's biology, meaning there's something different about certain individuals biologically or genetically. And you'll see under each biological perspective, there are, you know, various different theories. Our deviance book doesn't go into a lot, but I think looking at biological and psychological perspectives are still really important because, first of all, it's really criminology's history. So even though a lot of the research around this is now considered pseudoscience or fake science, it's still really important to understand the history of where we've come, because we're relatively new discipline. We're only maybe 150 years old. So the biological and the psychological often give us some understanding as to where we've come from. And it's not to say that these perspectives aren't important. They're definitely still relevant, but we also have to be really careful because they carry really heavy social policy implications. So the idea, if criminality or deviance runs in one's genes, then you would actually have to change the genes. And we've seen variations of this throughout history with the eugenics movement, where people were forcefully sterilized. And again, that idea was that if the criminal element ran in genes, then you stop, you know, that those genes from continuing on in the population. Within psychological explanations or perspectives of crime, a lot of times they were kind of lumped together with biological explanations. Our book is one of the first that I've seen it kind of separated, which is nice. But they're very similar. And essentially, we're saying that crime and deviance stem from one's psychology, or that, you know, the brains of certain individuals are fundamentally different. And again, if you believe that brains were different, then you would have to actually change the brains. And so we saw this happen with things like lobotomies, right? If you've ever watched One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, a lot of people think he's being electrocuted, but he's getting a lobotomy. They're essentially like killing his frontal lobes. And so it turns individuals into vegetables where they can't do much. And of course, it solves your crime and deviance problem, because they just kind of sit there and don't do much at all. But you can see how these implications are a little scary. Also, the other idea of, you know, it's the powerful who get to determine who is considered feeble-minded or weak-minded, which is, you know, been the understanding with eugenics. And when they actually looked at who was forcefully sterilized, they found that there was a lot of racial and gender bias, right? Where, you know, there actually wasn't anything wrong with these individuals, but they were labeled feeble-minded by certain people in power. So it's important that we reflect on this and understand the implications of these types of theories, and kind of understand where we've come from it now, like where we are in modern times when it comes to looking at things like biology, for instance, you know, certain genetic traits that might make people more prone to crime and deviance. In terms of psychology, we know that children who are diagnosed with ADHD are more likely to engage in crime and deviance later on in their lives. And so there's that component to it. So we're still using these ideas, but of course, you know, they have evolved significantly since our early days. So within this chapter, we're going to be discussing kind of the strengths and weaknesses around these particular perspectives. We'll also be looking at a lot of social structure perspectives, as well as what we call interactionist perspectives, also sometimes called social process. And so we're going to be looking at the sociology behind a lot of this as well. All right, so here's that picture of Jack Nicholson in One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest that I was discussing about the lobotomy, right? So actually kind of killing those that parts of the brain that were believed to cause crime and deviance. So this stuff, again, is really important for understanding our history, because early theorists, criminologists, they attributed deviant behavior to one's biology or psychology, essentially saying that there was something inherently different about criminals, right? That we've heard things like atavism, which was coined by a man named Cesar Lombroso, the idea that criminals are evolutionary throwbacks, or that they hadn't evolved in the same way as the rest of humanity. So again, we're saying that something is very different about these individuals, that criminals are born and not made. Cesar Lombroso also coined the term phrenology, and phrenology was based on measuring head shapes. So Lombroso thought he was using the scientific method. It seems very scientific, right? We're going to measure, and if we find that criminals have larger heads and skulls, which is what he found, then, you know, it does look like there's something fundamentally different about these individuals. It shouldn't be surprising that Lombroso's research was based on pseudoscience or fake science. He thought, he was using that method, but it was very much flawed. So in today's terms, we might actually do brain scans to look at an individual's brain. And, you know, they can tell us a lot, and you'll see this in one of our videos. But measurement wouldn't necessarily reflect differences. But of course, we see the inequality. So during Lombroso's time, he was an Italian criminologist, and he was finding things like that criminals had larger skulls, they were bulkier, hairier. I always got this kind of vision of like a Neanderthal type person, hairy, kind of, again, like that throwback, that evolutionary throwback. But again, there were some social inequality happening. So Lombroso was measuring the skulls of the people in prisons, and he was looking at Sicily. There was a large criminal element in Sicily, which is that little island off of Italy. But again, his science was flawed. So he was actually going into the prisons, you know, and measuring it and looking at these physical differences, without reflecting on the idea that there was social inequality. So the prisons were full of Sicilians who looked slightly different because regionally they came from a different land. And so it would be kind of comparable, or very much comparable, to us going into the prisons and saying all criminals are black because that's what it looks like, without understanding the social structure and why black individuals are more likely to be in the prisons because of things like inequality, labeling, and stuff like that. So it's kind of working backwards, but it doesn't kind of hold up from a scientific, you know, understanding. So, again, his research was seen as very flawed. The next theorist we'll look at is William Sheldon, and William Sheldon looked at what's known as somatology. And somatology was this idea of looking at body shapes and using body shapes as a way to determine kind of like personality types. He coined these terms, there was the ectomorph, the endomorph, and the mesomorph. And each body type, there was one that was more athletic. And he believed that the more athletic body type was more prone to violence or more prone to the criminal element. He looked at individuals that, you know, were seen as chubbier. And he said these people were less prone to crime and deviance. They were more jolly, jovial type people. And then the skinny individuals were people that were kind of antisocial. And if you reflect on some of these definitions, you'll recognize that, you know, they kind of fit with stereotypes that we see today. And, you know, even based on what he's saying, we could say like, well, athletic builds are more likely to be able to run or I don't know. So anyways, again, this was seen as pseudoscience, not scientifically sound, but this is our history. We have another explanation from a biological approach that looks at the XYY supermale. And this was the belief that certain males were born with an extra Y chromosome, which made them more violent. And in other books I've read that they were Seen as not as intelligent as others, but ultimately like hyper violent masculine, men. This again, I've seen as a, it's some people still believe in it, but most criminologists, this is seen as antiquated and outdated. There are some correlations, some good research around IQ levels and crime. We'll discuss that in a little bit. And I think that's what may be happening. I'm not necessarily sure, but again, this is our understanding. So one way that we might gauge or get some more understanding around the influence of genes or biology in terms of crime and deviance would be to look at identical twins. Because identical twins offer us this insight into the nature versus nurture debate, right? Identical twins have the same genetic code. And so, if we were to find identical twins that were raised apart but in similar social settings, so let's say they were adopted out and, both raised in middle class homes. Let's say that both kids end up at, going into crime and deviance. We go like, okay, well, maybe there is something genetic. It can't be their nature, or sorry, their nurture or their environment, right? Because these kids were raised in different environments. Because if they were raised together, we wouldn't be able to discern, well, maybe one brother influenced the other, and it was more social than it was genetic. And so, when we have twins that are raised apart, allows us this insight. And this term concordance means when one twin carries that deviant element, the other one does as well. So, what they found was that, in fact, there is a genetic piece to this, right? That identical twins reared apart did have, similar when one twin was deviant. It was often that the other one would be as well, but not always. And so that's what's really interesting is that there is a genetic play here, but it's not entirely genetic. There are still some social aspects of that as well. We can look at homosexuality from the same lens. So if you have identical twins, if homosexuality is 100% genetic, meaning you're born that way, then twins, that have the same DNA code. If one is gay, the other should be gay. What's interesting is that when you have one gay twin, there's a 50% chance the other will be gay. So only 50%, which is much higher than what you see in the general population in terms of homosexuality, which is about 10% of people identify on that spectrum. And so it's much higher than what you see, but it's not an end all be all. So even in being gay, there is an environmental component to this. And I think if we reflect deeply, we can understand this in terms of, well, if you grow up in a culture in which you can be killed for being gay, well, then that's not going to be very inviting. And maybe you won't even allow yourself to kind of think that way, right? So culture and environment and society do play into this as well. Maybe you have parents who, it doesn't mean you're not gay, but maybe you don't even allow your brain to consider a lifestyle in that way because of the culture. And so there's some really interesting studies in terms of concordance. And again, that really allows us this insight into the nature versus nurture debate. Okay, so continuing on, looking at biological theories of deviance, one of the most famous defenses that's oftentimes cited in criminology books looks at the Twinkie defense. And then the Twinkie defense was based on a case, you might be familiar with this individual. His name was Harvey Milk, and he was a gay activist in San Francisco. Harvey Milk was running for mayor, I think, and he was running against his opponent. His name was Dan White, and Harvey Milk ended up, winning. And this was in the 70s, in which, there was still a lot of discrimination and adversity for the homosexual population. And Dan White, his adversary, was so kind of upset about losing, I think, to this gay guy that he became enraged, and He ended up killing Dan White, or sorry, Harvey Milk, and another government official, and out of kind of rage around this. And he claimed the Twinkie defense. And so this became very famous. It was actually used in court. And the Twinkie defense was based on this idea. Dan White claimed that because he had eaten so much sugar that day that his hyperglycemic levels were like out of whack. And he used this as a defense for why he killed Harvey Milk and this other government official. Now, you might say this sounds totally insane and crazy, but Dan White ended up only getting 4 years for two murders, two homicides. And so essentially, he ended up getting off on the Twinkie defense. So, again, this stuff doesn't happen often, especially anymore. But with the Twinkie defense, we see the influence of how one's kind of society or culture or sociology influences their biology, right? So maybe in a culture where you have a lot of sweets, you're ingesting these sweets. We might look at, like, for instance, like, do lead levels influence things like behavior? And so here we're playing with this idea of how one's culture influences their biology. And so we call these biosocial theories. And you'll see that with any of these theories, there's an overlap. We'll look at psychosocial theories, where how one's society comes to influence their psychology. And we've talked a lot about this in this class already. So if you're wondering, do these overlap? They absolutely do. And I use this as a way to explain, from this Twinkie defense. Other ways in which we've used biological explanations, they've looked at things like hormones. And so, for instance, in understanding masculine kind of violence, we might say something like, well, it has to do with one's level of testosterone because most violent crime is committed by males. And so, there seems to be a lot of support for this. And even when women are given synthetic testosterone, they also become more violent. And so it's an interesting thing. I think, it does come into play. I think it's significant, but I think it's not, it's kind of like the gay thing we were talking about, where is it all biology? We also know that the society really pushes kind of things like hyper masculinity, especially in like lower income subcultures and things like that. And so, there could be an interplay of environment influencing that as well. It's not just the genes. So, something to think about. In terms of females, we know this is kind of an interesting one. Women in prison, they did a study and they found that women in prison, 50% of them had committed their crimes 1 week before their periods. And so, this is some interesting stuff. So, it's not all end all be all. PMS does not cause crime. But there's research that suggests that it might have something to do with female criminality. And this was used in a case in the UK in which a female was actually pretty much let off on the PMS explaining, the PMS defense. I don't recommend this one. If you want to kill your spouse or something, I don't recommend that this one will work for you. But there is some evidence that as females, we act a little differently around that time. And I can attest to that. So, some interesting stuff anyway. There's a video for you here that looks at abortion and crime. This one's pretty controversial, but I think once you watch the video, it makes sense. And I just wanted to give you this example as a way to illustrate this kind of biosocial, right? How one society, whether Roe v. Wade was legal or not, would influence things like one's biology, right? Or whether people were born or not. So, very kind of controversial theory, but if you look at the video, there's quite a bit of research that suggests there's something there. Some of the criticisms of biological theories. So, one, we've talked a lot about this. There's a long history of sexism and racism with genetics, with slavery, with the Holocaust, right? This idea that the belief that certain individuals were inferior, and using that as a rationalization for genocide and eugenics and all of these horrible things. So you want to be careful with that. So we go into this really I would say, kind of tepid. We're not gonna, you gotta be careful with these, right? Because they've been used as a justification for a lot of horrible experiments and things like that. The other criticism that comes with looking at biological theories looks at why an individual, and this is here where you have a psychological thing, why does a person who like is violent, why do some people turn to legitimate violence while others turn to illegitimate? So it doesn't explain that. So for instance, you know, someone who enjoys being violent might go into a job or a sport in which they can use this. So maybe I want to be in the military, right? Or maybe I want to go, if I want to beat the shit out of people, I want to go boxing or be a professional boxer or even just go to the gym and box, right? I want to hit people or bags or whatever. So it doesn't explain why some people turn to this like legitimate way of doing it while others turn to the criminal or illegitimate way of doing it. All right. So as I mentioned, psychological theories, very similar to biological theories, but they focus more on the mind or the psychology. Our father of psychology is known as Sigmund Freud, and Sigmund Freud coined the psychoanalytic theory. Some of you may be kind of familiar with this. So the psychoanalytic analytic theory says that we have parts of self that are in conflict with one another, and you know, when certain parts aren't kind of socialized in the right way, then people might be likely to turn to crime and deviance. So the three parts of self were, the first one is the id. The id is your hedonistic side. It's your pleasure seeking side. And so, you know, we all have one. So the id is that part of you that, you know, wants to eat the whole tub of ice cream or does eat the whole tub of ice cream, which is what I do sometimes. And then you feel really guilty about it, right? Because you're like, oh, what's wrong with me? Or that person who lays in bed and masturbates all day long watching porn or whatever. This is your self-serving side. This is your pleasure-seeking side. Your, you know, this is the side oftentimes you kind of hide from other people. Then you have this other part of self called your superego. Your superego is your overly socialized self, right? So this is the sociology or environmental part. The superego, you know, says, it's the part of you that says, wow, why did I just eat that whole thing or whatever, right? I don't want to do that again. I'm not doing that again. Or I need to go work out now to kind of balance this out. And so, you know, I always imagine the angel on your shoulder compared to the devil on your shoulder, if you remember those cartoons, right? The other part of self is your ego. And your ego plays the balancing act for the two. So your ego kind of recognizes both things at play, and it decides, you know, we want to make your id and your superego happy. So what can we do to kind of balance this out? So for instance, let's say a young man sees a really attractive female. His first kind of hedonistic reaction is, wow, she's really hot. I want to have sex with her. Or, you know, maybe he becomes aroused or something like that. And, but of course, it wouldn't be socially acceptable to jump on this individual, sexually assault them. In fact, that's a crime, and you know that, right? Or touching them inappropriately or something like that. So your ego plays this balancing act and says, hey, we would really like to have sex with her. Maybe we should do it in a way that, you know, society says is appropriate. And so maybe the ego would say, maybe you, you know, go ask her out on a date first, and then you sleep with her or something like that. So that is Freud's psychoanalytic theory, right? This balancing act between the id, the ego, and the superego. Next, we have social learning theory. And social learning theory looks at, this is both sociological and psychological, right? Or psychosocial, because we are like learning deviant acts through imitation and from people like our parents or friends or peers. But sometimes what happens is that, you know, certain individuals learn the wrong norms, right? They can think about a child who was taught that, you know, it's okay to steal, or their parents are getting them to steal for them or something like that. So you internalize these particular values or understandings of the world. And it's essentially learned behavior. So This theory could also fit really, or probably even better, into our sociology, right? This idea that criminal behavior is learned. But also think about things like the attitudes and the rationalizations. Those are all learned and internalized within one's psychology. Next, we'll look at IQ studies. So IQ studies are pretty interesting. When they survey people in the prisons, they find that a lot of times, you know, criminals do actually have a lower IQ. And I've actually become a little bit more interested in this recently. There are a lot of Netflix shows right now where they're looking at false confessions. And most people think, gosh, a false confession, why would you ever do that? Why would you ever confess to a crime that you did not commit? And what they're finding is that individuals with very low IQs are more likely to kind of revert to people who they perceive to be in authority to make decisions for them. So what ends up happening is that these individuals are interrogated for long periods of time. And you think about it, being interrogated for 16 hours, 20 hours, something like that, where eventually someone says, hey, if you tell us, you tell us what we want to hear, you can go home. Without understanding kind of the heaviness of what they're about to do. And now they're finding, you know, through DNA evidence that there were quite a few false confessions of where, you know, individuals are more likely to kind of revert to that. One was the case in Making of a Murderer, if you watched that on Netflix. His name was Brandon Dassey, and he was known to have a very low IQ. And if you're watching these confession tapes, I mean, you can see, right? He's saying, no, I didn't do it. And then it's kind of like changes. And then right after, he talks to his mom, and he's like, well, I just told them what they wanted to hear. And she's like, oh, my God. And so, you know, we also can consider the idea that people with low IQs, you know, might be vulnerable to people who are looking to manipulate them to do, you know, crimes that, or to do crimes in general, right, to kind of manipulate them into it, thinking that they have a better understanding. This next video here is a video from a man named Dr. Jim Fallon. He is a neuroscientist from UC Irvine, and he looks at brain scans of individuals. And so this is a more modern way of looking at psychological components or, you know, brain malfunctions. And there have been quite a few, you know, brain damage. For instance, football players who have had multiple concussions after concussions, there have been cases where they go on to kill their entire families, and their families say, I can't believe so-and-so did this. They never would have done it, and they really attribute it to this frontal brain damage. And so Dr. Jim Fallon really looks at this, but they also find that even with things like serial killers, most of the time, one of the underlying kind of aspects is that they're not all just psychopaths. They've also had that bad nurture. And so that's oftentimes what we find. There's an, you know, you do have to have the bad genes, but you also have to have the environmental trigger that kind of switches that on. And they find abuse in childhood is that environmental trigger. So in terms of most of our serial killers, they really are kind of a victim as well, because they're most of them have faced abuse. And a lot of criminologists think, you know, that's what's been going on. This was a trigger, and they did have the genetic code for it, but was it turned on or not turned on? And I think Jim Fallon's video does a good job of explaining that. Okay. The last part about criticisms is, again, you know, psychological and biological theories ignore the social conditions that might breed crime. They ignore things like the power dynamics of the powerful getting to determine who is mentally challenged or who is considered feeble-minded. Because there's obviously even things like the DSM, right? Psychologists getting to say that homosexuality is a mental disorder, which was, you know, here you have experts saying this, which we know is not. You had experts kind of, you know, getting to label homosexuals as mentally having a mental disorder, right? And now we go, okay, there's some major issues with this particular problem. All right. Okay, so we're going to shift gears a little bit here, and we're going to start looking at social structure. And so we call it the structural perspective. And so when I say social structure, I want you to consider the way society is set up. That's what we're talking about here. Because the way society is set up can have an influence in crime and deviance, right? So our father of sociology, Emile Durkheim, he did most of his research around this idea of structural functionalism. And he contends that it's the social structure in which people or humans learn things like the laws, the morals, and the values of society. And these were to constrain or inhibit certain individuals from committing crime or deviant acts, right? So deviance, he believed, is outside of the individual and embedded in that social structure. Right. So here he's not just looking at why people, you know, commit crime and deviance, but for the most part, he's looking at why people don't commit crime and deviance, because that question is just as important as why people do, because most people don't. Right. So Durkheim said that deviance is very functional for society. It creates a moral code. It creates cohesion and group solidarity. Right. When something horrendous happens, when there's a crazy murder or crime, it brings people together. It creates this kind of us versus them mentality. And, you know, reminds us of that right and wrong. And we see this kind of played out in things like the media, right? Where everything is kind of dramatized. The courtroom setting, the guy going in with handcuffs, he's in his costume, he's in his like prison garb, right? It's, think about it like a theater. It's all very dramatized. And while it's serving a function for, you know, the justice system who's trying to, you know, pin this guy for something, it's also serving a function for the rest of society in that reminding people, hey, this is not what is okay behavior. And so that's also something like really important to consider. So, you know, in terms of the way society is set up, we can look at how modern times have kind of changed the social structure and thus changed criminality. So for instance, for most of society, we were agrarian. We were farmers and we had what Durkheim called mechanical solidarity or a cohesion within the population because we all were really kind of based in, we were all invested in the same things. So if we were all farmers, the expectation was, you know, we all needed the sun to come out. We all needed our crops to flourish. If they didn't, we would all be screwed together. And so in some ways, this was really important, right? It created connection and ties to one another. But after the Industrial Revolution, this significantly changed the way society was set up because you started to see things like bureaucracy and hierarchy emerge within the factory settings, living in population-dense areas, people living on top of each other. Think of the farms as being spatially really spread out, right? Well, people living on top of each other is not good in terms of tension, right? If you've ever shared a room with someone, right? They always show like shows, TV kids shows where the kids split a line down the middle of the room, you know, whatever, because it creates tension, right? It's hard to live on top of each other. But also within the factories, right, you started to see power dynamics emerge. You have a boss, right, whose interests are very different than that of the guy at the very, very bottom, right? In fact, they might actually be in opposition to each other. So you have the boss who decides to lay everybody off so he can, you know, collect a bonus or something like that. So Durkheim believed the modern world had made people more distant from each other because we didn't have the same vested interests. He believed that this produced what we've talked about in this class, which was anomie, which is a sense of normlessness, right? Where norms weren't as secure as they were. They weren't as established. They were different depending on kind of what social position you were coming from. Durkheim believed that anomie would lead to greater degrees of deviance, right? Where if you don't feel like you can find fulfillment in this life because maybe you were kind of kept out of the main institutional settings or education or work, economics, then maybe you might turn to a different way to kind of fill those voids or those needs. All right, continuing on with the structural perspective presented by Durkheim, to add to that, Kai Erikson, another social psychologist, he believed that deviance created a contrast, which was really important for society. So think about, like we said, that theatrics involved with, you know, putting someone in prison or whatever. And also all the media associated with, you know, lockup and all these shows, CSI, all of this stuff, right? This creates that kind of contrast of like, hey, you know, those are the bad guys, we're the good guys. And this allowed for members of the society to really strengthen their convictions of what's considered moral or not. If you can imagine, you know, the attitudes around homosexuality have changed so much in the last 50 years. But it wasn't until, it wasn't until those attitudes changed that we would start to think about changing laws and things like that. So homosexuals were very much othered for a long time. This idea that those people are deviant and we are not, you know, you see this with, you know, the prisons are oftentimes put out in kind of rural areas away from society. We can point fingers and go, that's where those bad people live. There's even some really interesting research around segregation where, you know, segregation was where people of color were forced to live in certain areas. But there was a psychology that whites came to think that they were much more superior than people of color. And they'd say things like, well, look, their neighborhoods are run down. You know, there's crime, there's all of these things, without the larger, broader understanding that, you know, there were social conditions that were causing this. Blacks couldn't own property. So they were dependent on, you know, renting. They didn't make as much money in the society. So they would have to, you know, they would have extra people living with them. They would have more population dense areas. They didn't have the resources to keep their neighborhoods nice because they didn't have the money. And so but what's interesting is that whites came to think that they must be better because look at the way they live. And so there's some really interesting psychology around all of this as well. We also might consider how within the social structure, there's differential opportunity. Not everybody has the opportunity to be a white collar criminal, which is what is the it's most lucrative in terms of crime, right? You know, we have people who are bilking the system out of millions of dollars. You can see why that would be, I guess, a lot nicer option than going in and robbing a bank, right? It's cleaner to embezzle money through paper and pen than it is with a gun. Right. I don't want to put my, you know, if you just want money, then there's a lot easier ways to do it. And so this is something to think about, that within the social structure, not everybody has the same kind of opportunities. Even within particular subcultures, we'll find that certain subcultures don't have the same opportunities as well, just based on things like disposition or personality. Not everybody can be like a super hard ass gangbanger, right? Not everyone has that type of personality. And so even within certain subcultures, we'll see people kind of go into different aspects. The other thing to consider is that because of prejudice and discrimination, these are things that also influence social structure, right? Leaving certain groups, generally people of color and the poor, really kind of in desperate need. If you're left out of the main economic systems, you create your own. I say that over and over again, but it's true. And a lot of that is based on prejudice and discrimination. You know, like I said, for most of history, Blacks can hold certain jobs. There's a lot of American history that we never learn about that is really, really important in understanding things like the social structure and why some groups have been able to get ahead while others have not. So now we're going to talk about Robert Merton's strain theory. Strain theory. Robert Merton worked off of Durkheim's idea of anomie, okay? And he said that he came up with five typologies. So I need to explain kind of this, the schema right here. Take your eyes to this idea that says institutional means. What we mean by institutional means are, do people have the opportunities or means of achieving their goals, okay? Or are they left out? So for instance, growing up a white middle-class woman, I had the means, for instance, something like education to achieve my goals, right? I went to good schools, I had parents who supported me. The goals are, you know, so take your eyes to those cultural goals. The cultural goals are the goals of society. And under capitalism, Merton said that was, you know, stuff. That was the house, the cars, all of this, right? And so when we're talking about the social structure, we go, not everyone has access to the means to achieve the goals, right? There are a lot of really smart people in the inner city who just don't have the opportunities, right, to achieve their goals. And so Merton said that when people experience anomie, they will react in certain ways. The first typology that he coined was the conformist. And I would guess many of you are conformists because you sit in a college class most of the time, not today. But a conformist is someone who has the means of achieving the goals, and uses them. So for instance, going to school, right? School is your means. The goals are because one day you want a good job and you want all that stuff, right? Now, someone who grows up, you know, going to really shitty schools most of their life, might not have the opportunity to even go to college, right? They just don't know how to function on that level. They haven't been socialized into it. And so when people don't have access to these means, they create their own, right? And they're innovators. They come up with a new way of doing something. They still have the cultural goals, right? They still want all the stuff. So they might do something like sell drugs in order to achieve the societal means that they have. Bill Gates would also be an example of an innovator. He didn't use his socially acceptable means. You know, he said he's going to go create something in his garage, right? Most people, your parents would be like, oh, hell no, you're not dropping out of school to do that. And it worked out okay for him. But so there are different kind of forms of innovation. But even then, Bill Gates had, you know, some means. He probably had a decent support system from his family and stuff like that. The next typology is known as the ritualist. A ritualist is someone who accepts the means or has the means of achieving the goals, but they just don't necessarily want to. So a ritualist might be someone who just gets up and goes and works at their mediocre job, even though they might be really bright, but they're kind of okay within the ritual of just getting up, going to work, doing these things. I think we all know people like this. You think, wow, you have so much potential. You know, why are you doing this or whatever? But you know, I think the rituals are probably the most happiest people. But they have the institutional means, but they just don't necessarily use them. Okay. The next typology is a retreatist. And the retreatist rejects the institutional means or might not have them, and then also rejects the goals. So a retreatist, an example of a retreatist might be someone who is homeless by choice, not someone who's just struggling and can't get ahead because they still, you know, want to get ahead. But someone who's homeless by choice, someone who's kind of retreated from society. It's easier for me to go live in a tent. I don't have to deal with all this bullshit of life, work, and all this bullshit. I'm just going to go, you know, live in a tent and hang out and I'll be cool, right? Or, you know, I don't care if I don't have a house or whatever. So the retreatist is essentially retreated from society. Lastly, Merton coined the term the rebel. And the rebel, it's kind of interesting. Here it might not be so clear, but that's a plus and or minus, meaning they could use institutional means to achieve the goals, but they could not. So an example of a rebel might be someone like Martin Luther King. So he used institutionally sanctioned means, things like peaceful protest. Again, even at that time, it may not have even been acceptable, but he was really known for his nonviolence, right? So most people look at him and go, yeah, you did it the right way. And again, he wanted a change to the social order and he achieved some of that, right? I don't think Black people have the same type of opportunity as the dominant groups, but he made a huge contribution to the social order. Someone like Osama bin Laden would also be considered a rebel. So he did not use institutional means. He used a violent means to achieve his, you know, kind of a new world order as well. So again, this was Robert Merton strain theory. And this was a reaction to how people will adapt when they experience anarchy. So we're going to continue with structural perspectives. We touched on this in a previous slide, so we won't go too far into detail. But we'll also look at differential opportunities within certain social structures. And essentially, this was coined by a man named Olin. And Olin believed that all disadvantaged groups have some lack of opportunity for pursuing those legitimate goals. But not everyone has the same opportunity for illegitimate practices, meaning within certain subcultures, you know, certain people's dispositions or attitudes, you know, things like that. Not everyone can be Billy Badass out there. Just based on who they are, right? So not everyone can, you know, be a really great criminal or have, maybe you get caught the very first time, maybe you're just not very sly, whatever it is. Not everyone has the same access to illegitimate practices. So, you know, within deviant subcultures, you know, look at this gang here. Not everyone, again, can be badass. Some people will turn to be a retreatist. They'll kind of, when they're left out of the main economic system, they'll turn to drug use or alcohol use, kind of envision that bum on the side of the road. Other people, because of their internalized kind of oppression, they will turn to conflict or violence or fighting, right? So when I talk about criminal, we mean like criminal enterprises, like making money the criminal way. Other people might, you know, internalize this oppression and it might come out in violence or, you know, fighting or robbing someone or something like that. So it can be criminal, but you know what I mean. So in terms of this type of opportunity, so for one, certain groups have different access to criminal means. And so let's say, I don't think this in this picture, these guys are from the US. I think they're probably from some South American gang or something like that. But let's look at the Bloods and Crips, okay? Since we all kind of know that. Growing up white, I don't think you could have joined the Bloods and Crips, right? So if you were, not a lot, but if there were white people growing up in South Central, this wouldn't be an outlet for you, right? Because the Bloods and Crips were racialized. Maybe there would be another gang for you, but it wouldn't be that one. You also will look at the neighborhood, right? Even if you were Black, but if you weren't raised in South Central, let's say you were raised in rural Alabama, do you have access to be part of this gang? No, it's just not in your neighborhood. You'll also look at racial and ethnic domination. This goes again with the idea of like different access. Certain gangs are racialized. And then when it comes to groups, one thing I wanted to mention, so if we go back to this top one, groups have different access to criminal means. A better example would be to look at things like how one's social class influences kind of the type of criminal industry they can be involved in. So again, white collar criminals have access to people's bank accounts, right? That would be a lot easier than robbing someone or something like that. The other thing to think about is that there are also gender differences when it comes to this. Most gangs, for instance, in terms of hierarchy, women don't have the same type of status as males do. And oftentimes within gangs, their role is very secondary. So, you know, for women can be parts of gangs, but maybe they aren't part of the economic system within the gang. They're seen as, you know, they're not a primary member, they're secondary. Here we are. Here we have a slide here on feminist theory. Here we have some very angry females. And of course they should be angry because most of criminology and studies around deviance have left women out entirely. Now, I don't think that's totally random as most crimes committed, 90% of crime is committed by males. So, you know, there's a reason for that. But, you know, most feminists would say that, you know, it's really unfair and it really takes out the feminine experience in terms of crime and deviance. There are various ways of trying to understand why women engage in crime. Some feminists would trace it back to patriarchy, the idea of living in a male-dominated society where women have a very they're playing more of a subordinate role within the society. They don't hold the same positions of power as males. So when we're talking about differential opportunity, that would also be true for women, right? We don't hold these positions of power where we might have access to, you know, opportunity to commit crime. Women are also very much socialized to be nurturers. And so there's that aspect of this too. Men are socialized to be violent. We think about giving young boys boy guns and swords, and then we go, oh, don't kill each other. And we're like, well, what are you doing? Giving them, you know, practice, play, toys to kill each other. And so when women do engage in very violent crimes, they're almost held to a different standard because it is in contrast to how society sees females. So when women kill, we look at how, you know, they're looked at as super evil, right? Eileen Wuornos compared to Ted Bundy, you know, or like Ted Bundy killed a lot more people, but wow, Eileen, she's just not like, she's not a woman, right? We also might look at the oppressive nature of things like capitalism, right? Which might, a lot of feminists would say that this leaves, because women make less in this system, it leaves them oftentimes having to turn to crime or maybe even deviant careers as a way to sustain themselves. So, you know, if we look at our economic system, a woman without a college education doesn't have a lot of opportunities to create a lot of money. And I think that's true for males as well, but I think it's more true for females. So there are some jobs in which, you know, you work your way up. Union jobs are much more masculinized. But, you know, men can go into construction and make decent wage, not necessarily needing the education, but there aren't a lot of jobs for females that we think of as making a really good wage in the same way. And so some feminists would say that women are more likely to turn to crime as a way to sustain themselves or even deviant careers, right? Like being an exotic dancer, being a sex worker, things like that. And that's, they say it's based in the social structure, right? Where women aren't holding, you know, the same type of positions as men. We'll look at cultural perspectives. So these are sociological perspectives as well. And this looks at, you know, the norms and values and, you know, things associated with certain subcultures. So here we said membership in each group places people in distinct subcultures, each of which has distinct norms and values. So here in the picture, we have this, and this is actually a picture, I think, from the UK, but it says gentrify this. If you're not familiar with gentrification, it's this idea of, you know, what happens is rich people moving into areas that have historically housed poorer people, right? People, lower income people. And it's like, it's essentially what's happening in Seattle right now, where they move in. And you see this in places like White Center, where it's interesting. You see kind of old culture right next to new culture. So you'll have like these like kind of hipster restaurants right next to like older places that have been there for a long time. And this is this idea of the norms within these certain environments really changing. And what happens with gentrification is that it pushes people out that have lived there historically. So people of color in Seattle are moving south, 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 right? So they're moving to South Seattle, but they're moving even further. They're moving to places like Kent. They're moving to places like Tukwila because it's more affordable, right? But 10 years ago, maybe they've lived there for three or four generations. 10 years ago, they could still afford to live there, right? The rents weren't, right? But, you know, rents have quadrupled in a decade, which has pushed a lot of people of color out or people out onto the streets. And so with gentrification, it's really interesting. You have these groups, right, where the norms and values are very different. I went to a really interesting seminar last Thursday and Friday, and it looked at, very interesting, it looked at some of the gentrification happening in Seattle, and they mentioned Garfield High School. Some of you, I'm sure, might know about Garfield. I'm not from here, so I don't know about all these different high schools and stuff. But they talked about how, like, because of gentrification, the high schools were essentially split, where you had the white upper class students, and they were actually like on the top floors, who were in AP classes and like really excelled in doing all of these things. And then you had the groups that were there kind of historically, who were not doing as well, kind of in remedial classes, and they were literally divided between floors, where you have this one high school, and again, probably 10 years ago, it was not white, right? But you have this high school where you can see gentrification. And so what ends up happening is that obviously the norms of the upper class and the lower class are going to be, and values are going to be very, very different. And you're going to see tension arouse out of that. If you watch the news, people will talk about like, oh, all these homeless people out here, and they're not good for my business. They are dirty, they're littering, they have their RVs out here, they're an eyesore, things like that, where, well, why are they out there? Because they used to be able to afford rent here, now they have to live in tents. But that idea of, oh, this culture, they're loud, they paint their houses weird colors, that's been looked at in Latino culture, right? They have dogs, and so you start to see, as groups move, these kind of tensions emerge. So if we look at Celan's culture conflict theory, we can start to see how things like migration, how people moving from certain areas can create this tension in terms of norms. And you can see that with we had the Great Migration for African Americans moving from the South to places like Chicago and Baltimore and LA, right? And having to kind of realign their norms and learn new norms. You're coming from the South to the West or up North, it's going to be significantly different. So you see that happening. You also see it with takeover, or like I mentioned earlier, gentrification, right? So you have an entire group coming to take over what was once predominantly, lower income or different. And it changes the culture. So I had a friend who moved to San Francisco, and she was talking about how San Francisco isn't as fun as it used to be because the artists can't afford to live there anymore, right? It's one of the most expensive places in the country, and it's very unaffordable. And so you don't get, artists are generally don't have a lot of money, right? But they create what's kind of the fun part about the culture with any particular city. And yeah, in San Francisco, she was saying it's just not as fun as it used to be. And I think you're seeing that with Seattle as well, where people just can't afford to live there anymore. And so you're seeing the actual culture, not as fun, not as artsy. This can also clash, these tensions can clash at the border, right? Where, again, norms are very different right at that border. So you have sometimes more crime along the border, where there's more tension amongst groups, and the kind of old ways of doing things, new ways of doing things, that also plays into this. The other thing that happens in terms of norms is that children of immigrants often have the expectations of their family or the old ways of doing things culturally in conflict with, the new society or the new ways of doing things. And so there's these expectations of, oh, I remember one time a student telling me she was Filipina and her parents wouldn't let her go to prom because she wasn't allowed to date, until she was out of high school or something. And she was trying to explain, but prom is so important in American culture, but for them it was like a no-go. And she felt very kind of torn by this. And I think a lot of first generation students, when I bring this up in class, they're like, oh yeah, I totally get this, right? So that tension between the old ways and the new ways. So these are cultural perspectives continued. So we'll look at Albert Cohen, who did a study called Delinquent Boys, and his theory was really based on others' reactions. He found that working class males who came from a particular subculture, and especially those who came from deviant subcultures, had a different value system than the dominant, right? So if you envision, I like this little picture here of these kids smoking, it's so cute. But if you imagine these kids back in the day, going into school, right? Where out on the streets, things that are valued, being tough, I don't know, smoking when you're nine, whatever, however old they are. But they look like tough little bastards, they're just, you can see how those norms and values might not be appreciated in things like education or school, and how these kids could have a really tough time kind of acclimating to that culture. Because things like street smartness or maintaining autonomy, being sly, being able to outwit people. So every once in a while, I have groups of especially boys in my class who are, maybe what I would perceive to be a little rude. They're kind of joking around in class. And in my head, I'm just thinking, you're not doing what's smart for you, right? Which is like to not piss off your teacher. But I also reflect the idea that, some of my students come from different subcultures where, they feel like they need to impress their peers before they need to impress someone like me or someone in a authoritative position. So I have that understanding in terms of why, some kids might act out like this, but not everyone does. And so you can see why. Some people might kick them out of their class or whatever. And so the things that are valued within their particular subcultures aren't valued in kind of middle class values, because ultimately Cohen believed, hey, you're going to be judged by middle class values, right? And so you can see where they would feel some sort of strain, like, hey, I can't be successful in school. I just don't even know how to act. And they'll consider what's known as status frustration. And again, they're more likely to turn back to their lower class kind of subculture because that is where they are kind of rewarded for the behavior that they ascribe to. And that's known as lower class culture theory. Okay, next we'll look at interactionist perspective. In criminology, it's called social process, for those of you who have a crime background. And interactionist perspectives look at the micro. So they're looking at interaction among small groups, amongst people like peers, family members, friends. And it helps explain where the structural explanations left off. So what I mean by that, so we can look at the social structure and say, well, it makes sense why lower class boys are more likely to engage in deviance, right? They're left out of the main economic system or whatever. But even within these lower income areas, most people don't turn to criminal or deviant acts. Most people are conformists, in fact. And so interactionist perspectives help explain why maybe one boy decides to go into that subculture and another one, maybe who lives right next door, does not. Okay, so this explains, hopefully that makes sense, how maybe one individual, goes into one area and another doesn't. So we're looking at the social psychology, right? Factors that might influence this might be one's family. There are a lot of families in the lower income inner cities that really push education. They know this is their only way their kids can get out. I know within Latino culture, they're really pushing education. A lot of my first generational students feel a lot of pressure because they're first generation college students and everyone in their family wants them to succeed. That's a lot of pressure that not all students have. And so they got a lot on their shoulders, and that might influence, for instance, why they might stay on the straight and narrow. So the most famous theory of all time is differential association. And one reason why it's so famous is because Edwin Sutherland, who coined it, it essentially says that deviant behavior is learned through your intimate friends or intimate interactions. And the reason it's so famous is because it's so simple and it makes sense. And they say that the best theories are the most simple. But differential association contends that because individuals learn things like norms and values and things like family settings or peer settings, so for instance, it shouldn't be random to you if a kid has criminal parents who have taught him to be, maybe they're teaching him to steal as young as 2 or 3 years old. Well, what chance did this kid have, right? His parents were telling him to do that. But kids also learn things like rationalizations. In a documentary I watched one time, they talked about how, you know, God would understand why we're committing crime because he knows how hard it is out here. Like, that's what one of the kids said. And so that's a rationalization, and that's an appeal to a higher power, this idea that, you know, yes, we're committing crime, but God would understand. Or, hey, I only stole bread because you would too if you were in my situation. I had to feed my children or whatever. But criminals always make rationalizations. I shoplift because, you know, the store rips me off every time I go shopping there. Or they've already accounted for shrinkage. Or I'm going to steal from my employer because he doesn't pay me enough. On and on. Everybody makes rationalizations. But what's important in terms of this theory is that those rationalizations are learned. Also, things like techniques are learned. So, for instance, you know, when I shoplifted in my early teens, or it was a preteen maybe even, but I actually learned how to do this through close association, my best friend, right? We were stealing scrunchies, and she showed me scrunchies that go in your hair. I know it's really embarrassing now, but she was, I watched her do it first, and then I went and did it, right? So I don't know if our technique was so great, but I watched her do it, and then, you know, and ultimately this was the friend I also got caught with like 2 years later. So that's interesting. You also learn things like the status system of the subculture, right? So if you're growing up in a gang infested area, you'll learn that being violent might gain you a lot of status or prestige amongst the group, right? Maybe a drive-by shooting will, you know, hoist you up into a position of leadership within the gang. What's also cool about differential association is it helps us understand not just crime by the lower class, but also crime by the upper class. So Edwin Sutherland, who coined this theory, also did a lot of research in white collar crime, and he coined the term white collar crime. And he said that white collar criminals learn crime in the same way that street criminals learn crime, that oftentimes within a certain organization, there might be a culture that pushes profit at any cost. Maybe, you know, within the system that you're working, maybe deviance and crime is the norm, right? Maybe things like finding loopholes in the law. You know, we see this over and over again, but, you know, it's also true for individuals of high social standing. And just so you know, white collar crime is considered crime generally for financial gain by those in positions of power. So political crime would be considered white collar crime if it's for financial gain, or, you know, embezzling money, for instance. But again, all of these techniques, rationalizations are learned. Even Bernie Madoff, who stole, was the biggest white collar criminal of all time. He built $1 billion from people, right? And sometimes those people say, well, the upper class have quite a bit of money. I heard things like nobody would invest money that they couldn't afford to lose. So even then they're using these rationalizations. Wow, it is really snowing right now. Fun stuff. Okay, so continuing on with our interactionist perspectives, we have a theory by Mopsa. Another man that he worked with, was his last name was Sykes. So Sykes and Mopsa released what was known as the neutralization and drift theory. And this essentially said that, especially in terms of juveniles, it's not like juveniles are committing deviant or criminal acts all the time, that in fact, they kind of drift in and out of it, kind of depending on, you know, what's going on in their life. So for instance, it really gives us this understanding of, you know, people with their foot in both worlds. So you could be maybe a college student and you're selling drugs on the side, and it allows you to kind of try these new identities out without like letting go of that other one. So, and I think this is ultimately what happens for a lot of kids, is that depending on how successful you are, so maybe you're a college student, you're going to school, but you're like, damn, I'm selling drugs, this is making me really good money. And, you know, you're doing great, and then you get caught, you know, and then you're like, okay, I don't want to do this anymore, blah, blah, blah. But then you also, you know, a year later, I don't know, your girlfriend gets pregnant and you gotta, I don't know, get money for the baby. I don't know. And so you're like, I'm just gonna do one more kind of drug big deal and get this money and then come back. I've seen this on a lot of like of those true crime documentaries. Oh, I wasn't gonna do it again, but just one more time, right? But this idea is that people drift in and out of criminality, and it allows them to kind of play the role before they like legitimately change their status. So allowing one to try out the deviant worlds and drift in between delinquency and legitimacy. We also have Sutherland's labeling theory. We're not going to go into this one so much because we've already gone through it a lot, but just to kind of recap, labeling is more interested in social reactions or, you know, the labeling of particular individuals. And it generally happens when one gets caught. So if you're doing all of this stuff and no one finds out, well, good job, right? You haven't got caught and no one really knows what you're doing. It's when people come to find out what you're doing or that you're labeled either officially within the system, so now you have a criminal record, or maybe you're unofficially labeled. So maybe your parents realize you're engaging in deviance or people in the neighborhood, you know. And as we've talked about so often, that label will come to kind of haunt you in our system for many people for the rest of their lives if they have an official kind of record within the system where, you know, it makes it very difficult for people to get jobs. If you have to mark your convicted felon to find housing because they do background checks for that. I mean, and all of these kind of these avenues close off to you. And again, kind of make you an outsider to your society. Even at my daughter's school, you have to get a background check to volunteer, which I guess, you know, makes sense. But when we look at how many people, you know, did something maybe 10 years ago and they still can't volunteer at their kid's school because they, you know, got caught selling drugs when they were 18 or something. Again, nonviolent offense. So we can come to see how deviance is more so a result of other people's reactions to the act. Okay, so here from the interactionist approach, we'll look at control theory to deviance. This was coined by a man named Travis Hershey. And Travis Hershey looked at what kept people, not what pushes people into crime, but what actually kept people from committing crime. Because again, like I mentioned, even in low-income areas, most people are not committing crime. They're law-abiding people, right? And he really said that it had to do with our social bonding to people like our families, our peers, and the institutions in which we feel we are a part of. And so generally, through the life course, as people age, they fall out of crime. As people get older, you know, they're more likely to be law-abiding. A lot of that is because the ties that they have to society are a lot stronger. So for instance, you know, some people have a kid and they're like, damn, I can't live this lifestyle anymore. I love this kid too much. I don't know, we're gonna move away from the gang, away from this place. I just care about my kid too much. Sometimes people are like, hey, I actually got a really good job. I don't wanna lose this job. I don't wanna lose this opportunity. And so, again, that bond to their jobs is really important. We might say something like bonds to religion or to, you know, the religious community, keeping people kind of on the straight and narrow. So, again, Hershey would say those who have a stronger bond to society are less likely to deviate from the norm, right? And then also, if those ties suddenly become if those bonds suddenly become broken, let's say this individual in the picture, his wife leaves him and she marries another man and, you know, his kid is being raised by another man or something, we can see again why he's more likely to kind of fall into maybe alcoholism, drug use, right? We saw during the Great Recession, men who were laid off from their jobs. One thing I saw a couple times was that, you know, they got laid off and then they would like kill their entire families and then themselves. So instead of just killing themselves, they brought their entire families with them because that tie, that outside bond was severed. Okay. All right, our last slide here. So chapter six, if you recognize from the book, it only had three or four pages that looked at functionalism, Durkheim. And so I'm not gonna go so far into this because I feel like when we just discussed social structure, we discussed a lot of this. But I thought it would be important just to kind of recap some of Durkheim's main ideas. So he said we could compare society to a living organism. And where we are essentially a bunch of interconnected parts through things like institutions. So we have all these institutions working together, things like healthcare, education, government, business, law enforcement, or you know, the criminal justice system, anything that's a system, the family is a system. And that you have these interconnected parts keeping society functional, right? And he said there was nothing pathological about crime and deviance, that all societies had it. And in fact, it was very normal and we needed it for, you know, certain functions. There were certain functions associated with deviance, things like cohesion, creating identities for people, like, right, we wanna be on the good team. We wanna be seen as moral by the society. Because a lot of us, even if we didn't get caught, we would never engage in crime and deviance because we don't wanna feel bad inside. Again, he thought it was normal in all societies. He thought it was really important for things like social change. And he said, as attitudes change within the culture, you would see the attitude, you know, as attitudes change about certain aspects of culture, you would see it change in legislation, right? So as soon as attitudes became overwhelmingly one way, we would start to see changes in the laws, like, you know, attitudes around homosexuality have changed significantly in the last 50 years. Thus, we've seen gay marriage legalized. Attitudes around marijuana have changed significantly. Thus, we see, you know, marijuana laws changing. And so, you know, it was mentioned in your book that even if we didn't have crime and deviance, some new behavior, and it's hard for me to even think about that, some new behavior would emerge as deviant. Like, you'd always have that yin and yang. You always need the good to have the evil kind of type thing. So that's it for this lecture. And I know this was a longer lecture than normal, but please reach out if there's anything that you're having a hard time with. I know it's difficult because I can't stop to ask if you're understanding it. But I also want to remind you that, you know, these theories are not new. And most of these theories have an entire book written about them. So we're really just kind of summarizing them in this lecture. But if there's anything that you're like, huh, I'm still having a hard time kind of grappling with this one, Google it. You know, I oftentimes Google things all the time. So I'm like, I don't really remember this one, or it's new or whatever. But there's so much information online around this. But of course, reach out to me. I don't know how much longer we're going to have with these lectures. It might be another week or two. So let's work together and hang in there, reach out, and enjoy your snow day.